want to.
Okay. Now, we are going to have an early speech at lunch because our speaker is ready. We want to create a little break time between the end of the luncheon address and the CLE so you can fortify yourself for the ethics requirement. Now, I'm not here to introduce our speaker, but I just want to say a word about Phil Miscimarra. I was a little bit worried after Bill Gould became chair of the NLRB that academics would no longer be appointed to important positions at the NLRB. And I am happy to see, I don't know if this was true of Craig Becker, was he an academic at that point? Craig Becker also had problems. You know, people are generally allergic to academics at the NLRB. And I think poor Craig suffered from that post-Gould reaction. But I am happy to report that Philip has done such a good job of disguising his academic background. Many, many years at the University of Pennsylvania Wharton School, worked very closely with Herbert Northrop, and then he became was at the same time a management labor lawyer. Now, I've tried doing that. It hasn't worked as well for me. That's why I'm now a Lone Ranger. In both my academic and lawyerly pursuits. Karen Fernbach is the regional director for Region 2. I don't believe she went to NYU School of Law, but we adopted her. And we love our adopted children every bit as much as the so-called natural-born children. But for many years, she's been an associate member of the advisory board. And I'm pleased to say that she'll be introducing our speaker.
Is that on? I guess so. I just want to thank you, Sam. It's really a privilege to be here today. I want to tell you that I have never missed one of Sam's conferences from the time I was a bargaining unit member, a supervisory attorney, a trial attorney, and many of the people from the regions are all here. And
I'm glad you're attributing the ascent of your career to your affiliation with me. I think it may be a bit overstated, but I will take the credit anyway.
Okay, take the credit. You love taking the credit.
Yes.
In any event, it is really a pleasure to introduce the Honorable Board Member Philip A. Miscimarra, who gave me the privilege of calling him Phil after I introduced him. He's really a great, great person. I just met him, actually, for the first time, admittedly, this afternoon when he arrived. And he is not a New Yorker, so let's be kind to him. Seriously, he is a very multi-talented board member. Let me tell you about the Honorable Phil A. Miscimarra. He was sworn in as a member of the NLRB on August 7th, 2013, for a term that expires on December 16th, 2017. Mr. Miscimarra was nominated by President Obama on April 9th, 2013, and he was approved unanimously by the Senate Committee on Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions on May 22, 2013, and confirmed by the Senate on July 30, 2013. I'm going to call you Phil, okay? Yeah. Phil previously, I'm reading from the bio, I'd rather be more natural. Phil was previously a labor and employment law partner with Morgan Lewis and Bacchius in Chicago, and as Sam noted, he was a senior fellow in the Center for Human Resources at the University of Pennsylvania's Wharton Business School. Before joining Morgan Lewis and Bacchius in 2005, Phil was a labor and employment attorney with Safeforth Shaw in Chicago, Murphy Smith and Polk in Chicago, which is now the offices of Ogletree, Deacons, Nash, Smoke, and Stewart, and Reed Smith, Shaw and McClay, now Reed Smith. He received his Juris Doctor from the University of Pennsylvania School, a Master's in Business Administration from the University of Pennsylvania's Wharton Business School, and a Bachelor of Arts degree, summa cum laude, from Duquesne. And Phil is a very multi-talented attorney, not only as a board member. He is a prolific scholarly writer. He has written and was the author or co-author of several books involving labor law issues, including the NLRB and managerial discretion, subcontracting, relocations, closing sales, layoffs, and technological change, and the NLRB and secondary boycotts, and government protection of employees involved in mergers and acquisitions, which, and among other publications. So he's, you know, he is well published, and he's a very impressive person that we have now as a member of the board. And one other thing that's not in here, which I was able to find out, is that he's very talented. He was a professional pianist, musical director, and a vocal coach. And so a true Renaissance man we have here at the NLRB, and it is my pleasure to introduce Phil Miscimarra.
It's my biggest fear in life that everyone will quickly come to the conclusion that I don't measure up to my introduction. Also, I realized that if I stand at the podium, I will actually be shorter than if I sit at the table here. So I'm going to stay here, if that's okay with everybody. And I want to thank Karen for her introduction, of course, Sam S. Stryker for the invitation to be here today. I also want to acknowledge James Paulson, the regional director for Region 29 here. And, you know, this has been a very important conference, and it's appropriate that to have it here at NYU with co-sponsorship from Cornell ILR School and St. John's University. Each of these programs have such a significant, longstanding commitment to labor and employment law. And that's been demonstrated, I think, by the incredible batting order of speakers that have appeared both yesterday and today. The subtitle of this conference is the in recognition of the 80th anniversary of the NLRA. And, you know, I might suggest an adjustment in the title, although Sam's probably now thinking it's too late to change all of the programs. But in my Senate confirmation hearing, I indicated that I would do everything I could to recognize the career professionals that do so much of the board's hard work. That's especially true in Region 2, in Region 29 here in New York and Brooklyn. And so my adjustment to the subtitle of the conference would be not only to recognize the 80th anniversary of the NLRA, but also the 80th anniversary of so many NLRB staff members and agency professionals who really are the face of the board, and in my career have been the face of the board to me as well, in not only in Washington, D.C., but in all of the regions throughout the country. The other thing is, you know, I know that you, everyone heard yesterday at the beginning of the program from our general counsel, Dick Griffin, and then board member Kent Hirazawa was the lunch speaker yesterday. And so I'll start out with a confession. I am not as articulate as Dick Griffin, and I am not as smart as Kent Hirazawa. And I fear that I don't even get honesty points, because right around now you would all be coming to that conclusion yourselves anyway. So, but recognizing the 80th anniversary of the NLRA, I can say some things about serving on the National Labor Relations Board. And one thing that I'll note, I'll say some things about the board, some things about the board's special friends, our relationship with Congress and our relationship with the courts. With respect to the board, you know, I think every board member discovers very quickly, serving on the board, I am not alone. And our statute is constructed in a way where in every case, board members have to formulate what the right thing to do is in the case alone first. And then we go into an agenda room and we end up finding out in many cases, not certainly not all, but in many cases we find out that other board members may have formulated very, very different viewpoints about very close factual distinctions in many cases. Questions concerning policy and the application of our statute. John Fanning served on the board for 4 days short of 25 years. and he participated in more than 25,000 NLRB cases, both in Democratic and Republican administrations. And he said, the one thing that every case has in common are two people who see things completely different. And that's certainly true. But, you know, that also says something, I think, I want to make one comment about the functioning of the current board. You know, there are many cases that where the board is unanimous with respect to the case generally or particular issues. And I know that often people use the word partisan to talk about, you know, either the process of having people nominated to be members of the board, or sometimes people talk about a divided board issuing decisions that have been issued on the basis of partisan votes. And, you know, I think with respect to the current board, when we do have those instances where there are diverse views or differences of opinion, those differences relate to our statute, the statute that Congress gave us, or very significant issues in particular cases. And, you know, part of the conference over the past 2 days has dealt with who is the employer, who is the employee. And I'll use one case as an example, which is the cable news network case, which dealt with significant joint employer issues and was decided last September. In the CNN case, CNN had a 20-year history of relying on outside contractors for their technical employees. In Washington, D.C. and New York. The contractor and its predecessors was unionized. The contractor had its own collective bargaining relationship with its unions, and the collective bargaining agreements identified the contractor as the employer, and there were also NLRB certifications that consistently identified as the employer the contractor with no reference to CNN. And CNN's service agreement with the contractor and the series of successive contractors stated that only the contractors were the employer, and CNN was not permitted to act as the employer with respect to the technical employees supplied by the contractors. So the board majority in the CNN case concluded, in addition to the contractor, CNN was also an employer, a joint employer, and based on the joint employer finding, the board concluded that CNN, when it decided to discontinue its 20-year relationship with the contractor, CNN unlawfully failed to give the contractor's employees notice, and CNN unlawfully failed to engage in bargaining with the union that represented those employees. Now, the joint employer finding in CNN stemmed from aspects of the relationship that, without question, involved significant contractual or de facto control. And, you know, I'll note in the case that the contractor was required to supply technical employees to CNN 24 hours a day or 7 days a week. CNN furnished all of the equipment used by the technical employees. The contractor was required to give CNN's needs top priority before servicing anyone else. CNN also paid for all of the personnel-related expenses with a cap of 4% annually in terms of what CNN would reimburse. Now, I dissented in CNN from the joint employer finding because in my view, based on the facts, there was no reasonable way that CNN could have known it was the employer, which was contrary to a 20-year history when nobody understood CNN to be the employer in the case. And, you know, I think one of the important factors at issue in a case where you're trying to figure out who the employer is whether the employer can reasonably understand that it is the employer, which is important, especially when you're talking about bargaining obligations, because we remedy violations of the act, but part of 8A5 and 8B3 in our statute is so parties can actually comply with the statute and do what we require of them, which is to get together, confer in good faith with respect to wages, hours, and terms and conditions of employment. So in the CNN case, I indicated under our statute that employer status, the phrase I used, does not arise as a result of spontaneous combustion. And I think that's right, but so from my perspective, the facts in CNN were insufficient to result in a finding of joint employer status, although the majority of the board disagreed with that. And I use that as an example because it does highlight some things, I think, about the current board. And I'll make just a couple of points. One point is, you know, there are significant issues, even in the CNN case, where the board was unanimous. We unanimously agreed that when CNN assumed direct responsibility for the technical work that had previously been outsourced, the board was unanimous that CNN became a legal successor employer with an obligation to recognize and bargain with the union. We were also unanimous that CNN, in connection with certain hiring decisions, engaged in anti-union discrimination in violation of Section 8A3. Another point that I'll make is, you know, our economy does give rise, and I know other speakers have spoken in much more detail about this, our economy gives rise to very challenging issues when it comes to identifying the employer. And without question, we have equally challenging cases about who is the employee in a number of different contexts. And then the last point that I'll make is when it comes to the current board, you know, the board is really working very hard, all five board members, to address these issues in a manner that has a grounding in our statute and not simply trying to do what feels good in a particular context or in a particular circumstance. And one of the funny things when, you know, when I started at the board, it was in August of 2013, and there were four new board members. Five board members were all confirmed at the same time, and four were brand new board members. So one of the things that I had to learn, all of us, with the exception of Chairman Mark Pierce, we had to learn how to be board members. So we were kind of figuring out how to be board members, and we were addressing issues as they came up. And in my second week at the agency, apparently there is this rampant discussion going on among the staff attorneys that, oh my gosh, the board members, they're actually talking about cases in agenda meetings. And I thought that's what board members are supposed to do at agenda meetings. And for sure, at least in my experience, the board, we've had five very experienced labor lawyers, five people that have had a lot of experience with collective bargaining, and we have speaking agenda meetings that involve very detailed discussions about cases and the factual record, and board members bring in copies of exhibits from cases. And you know, this is the decision making at the board as a matter of process has been much more principled and has involved a more extensive discussion than I think many people would believe if you just take a look at what comes out of the agency. So, you know, I said before in the board's 80-year history, you know, every board member learns very quickly that I am not alone. Well, another thing that we've learned in the course of eight decades is the NLRB is not alone. So it turns out, I said before, the board has some special friends. And, you know, it turns out we have two special friends. One's Congress, and one's the Supreme Court, and I'll include in that the U.S. Courts of Appeals. And, you know, I'm not 80 years old. Some of you may be thinking, wow, he looks 80 years old. I'm not 80 years old, but I have learned that a lot happens when particular friendships and relationships go from the months or years into the realm of decades. First, it sometimes becomes hard to describe the relationship. Second, you learn that relationships change from time to time. Third, even when you have good friends, some of your friends may not only turn against you, sometimes they gang up on you. And finally, whenever a long-lasting relationship has a lot of ups and downs, eventually you learn the other person is not going away. And all of those things, I think, have characterized the relationship that has existed for 80 years between the NLRB in Congress and the NLRB in the courts. And you know, I'll start and just say a few things about Congress, and I have to tell you, I have a great amount of anxiety talking about the board's relationship with Congress, and it's for this reason. I've done this before. A couple of years ago, I gave a joint presentation talking about the relationship between the NLRB and Congress. And my co-presenter at an ABA meeting was Nancy Schiffer, who at the time, I was in private practice, Nancy was Associate General Counsel of the AFL-CIO. And we apparently caused so much anger based on our presentation that we both got appointed to the National Labor Relations Board. Yeah, so Sam just said, serves you right. So I don't know what worse things can happen as a result of further comments on the relationship between the board and Congress. But I'll just make basically two points. One, Congress has a very important oversight role regarding the NLRB that is integral to what we do, and it will not go away. The NLRB owes its existence to Congress. Congress is responsible for considering potential amendments to our statute. I mean, after all, Congress adopted our act in 1935, had very important amendments in 1947, 1959, 1974. Nominations to the board can only be made by the president with the advice and consent of the Senate, which was reaffirmed by the Supreme Court in the Noel Cannon cases. And last but not least, the board is dependent on the House and the Senate when it comes to the board's appropriations. So there you have it. The second point about the board's relationship with Congress is, I'll say this, I really wish board member Lauren McFerrin was here because like all of the board members, by the way, she's also smarter and more articulate than I am. So sorry about that, she's not here, you're stuck with me. But she also spent her last 9 years before transitioning to the board as senior counsel to the Senate Labor Committee. And ironically, not only is Member McFerrin stuck dealing with all of the rest of us, she has the additional indignity of having played a significant role in vetting all of the rest of us. So some of us have been known to remind her at various times, sometimes in amusing circumstances, what an important role she did in the process of having each of the rest of us vetted when we were pending Senate confirmation. So that's Congress, and I'll now talk just a little bit about the board's relationship with the Supreme Court and the courts of appeals. And I'll make, again, here, I'll make three points as well. Observation number one, all friendships at some time involve a test of loyalty. And many cases have forced courts to indicate whether, in that particular case, they are a special friend of our agency. So at an early stage, the Supreme Court passed the test. And in NLRB versus Jones and Lachlan Steele, the court not only upheld the constitutionality of our statute, but even then, by the way, parties criticized the, quote, attitude of the board, and the board was accused of being, quote, hostile towards employers. And the Supreme Court said, the record presented no ground for setting aside the order of the National Labor Relations Board in that case. However, even in Jones and Lachlan, the court indicated that its friendship with the board would have limits, and that set the stage for 78 years marked by ups and downs in our relationship. So in Jones and Lachlan, the court stated, the employer may not intimidate or coerce employees with respect to their self-organization or representation. On the other hand, the board is not entitled to make its authority a pretext for interference with the employer's right of discharge for other reasons than intimidation and coercion. Now, my second observation is this. The board certainly has had its ups and downs with the Supreme Court and the courts of appeals. There are many cases, the biggest one perhaps is Erie's Resister Corporation, where the Supreme Court said the board has the, quote, special function of applying the general provisions of the act to the complexities of industrial life. But the love pendulum between the courts and the board has also sometimes swung the other way. In American Shipbuilding Company, a case decided in 1965, the Supreme Court said, we think the board construes its functions too expansively when it claims general authority to define national labor policy by balancing the competing interests of labor and management. So it's the relationship has gone up, it's gone down, and you can even take a look in the past 5 to 10 years, many examples where the board and the courts have had things go swimmingly in other cases where there's been tension and some disagreement between the board and the courts. And that brings me to my last and final observation, which is no discussion would be complete of the board's special relationship with the courts without talking about what we call our doctrine of non-acquiescence. And I'll tell you what that means. When a particular circuit court of appeals has squarely rejected a particular principle that has been adopted by the board in many cases before the same court will continue to apply board law and not the law devised by the particular court of appeals. By the way, we try to do that as politely as possible. So many people regard the board's non-acquiescence doctrine as principled or even courageous, because in fact there are many instances in which the Supreme Court has ended up, after many years of disagreement, agreeing with the board contrary to differing views expressed by several courts of appeals. And, you know, in the 70s, there was a tug of war about whether or not cafeteria vending prices was a mandatory subject of bargaining. Ultimately, the Supreme Court decided the issue the board way and not in line with many of the courts of appeals. Similarly, in the 1980s, another issue, whether strike replacements could be presumed to oppose the union for purposes of evaluating withdrawals of recognition. Once again, many courts disputed the board's position that a presumption of opposition to the union was inappropriate. The Supreme Court ultimately upheld the board then as well. Now, other people sometimes use adjectives like reckless or arrogant to describe our non-acquiescence doctrine. And I'll just say, who could forget what the Ninth Circuit stated in NLRB versus Ashkenazi Property Management? In that case, the Ninth Circuit, apparently infuriated, gave this admonition to the board. Administrative agencies are not free to refuse to follow circuit precedent in cases originating within the circuit, unless the board has a good faith intention of seeking review in the particular proceeding by the Supreme Court. Any future act of non-acquiescence should be dealt with by this court so that we may address the agency's violation of the rule of law. The Third Circuit, in another case, A. Dewey Pyle, also stopped being a special friend to the agency, at least for purposes of that case. The board had applied a certain principle of law. The court rejected it. The board, in a later case, once again applied its own law, and the Third Circuit said, this is a quote, we have made it crystal clear that a board's decision ignoring our precedents will not be enforced. We do not propose to abdicate our responsibility to an administrative agency. We have a special word at the board we use for those kinds of opinions. It's called ouch. So, you know, at, the current board, we find ourselves that the courts will continue to be a special friend in some cases, not a special friend in other cases. You know, interestingly, some of you may have seen we sometimes do have disagreements with respect to particular issues or particular cases. What that raises is the specter in some cases that the courts will be special friend to some board members and not others. If you take the board's decision last year, Pacific Lutheran University, the board majority courageously adopted a standard governing when the board should exercise jurisdiction over religiously affiliated educational institutions. The board majority adopted a standard that differed from the standard that had been embraced by the Court of Appeals for the DC Circuit. In Pacific Lutheran, I was not quite so courageous, and I expressed my support for the standard that had been embraced by the Court of Appeals for the DC Circuit. Another case, probably one that is even more well-known, famous, or infamous, is the board's position with respect to class waivers, class action waivers, which the board held are violations of Section 8A1 of our statute in a case, D.R. Horton, and also which was reaffirmed by the board in Murphy Oil. Well, it turned out the D.R. Horton case was overturned by the Court of Appeals for the Fifth Circuit, and it's turned out by dozens of other federal courts, both district courts and courts of appeals. So in Murphy Oil, the board majority once again adhered to the board's view that class action waivers violate Section 8A1. And once again in Murphy Oil, I exhibited no bravery at all, and I expressed my view that our statute, I think, does not dictate or prohibit any particular class or non-class treatment of non-NLRA claims. So I'll end by quoting what the Court of Appeals for the D.C. Circuit said in another case called Dubuque Packing Company. And most of you probably know Dubuque Packing deals with this important issue of whether or when a work relocation could be considered a mandatory subject of bargaining. And what the court said in Dubuque Packing was, and again, this is a quote, "This case presents hard questions, indeed, some of the most polarizing questions in contemporary labor law. While we're sympathetic to the task that lies ahead for the National Labor Relations Board, our sympathy does not lead us to shirk our duty to hold the board accountable for the rationality of its decisions." So there you have it. You know, we have relationships with the courts where the courts, for many reasons, owe deference, significant deference, to the decisions of the NLRB. I suspect, with respect to the questions being addressed in this important conference, which is who is the employee and who is the employer, it's going to be an important issue for the board to continue to address, and I suspect at some point there may be opportunities for the courts to express their opinion, perhaps Congress too. So I'll stop there and just say again, this has really been an incredible conference. It's dealing with extremely important issues, and it really is an honor to be here, and I'll be happy to answer some questions as well. Question?
I think my first question is with respect to the CNN case that you referred to.
Yeah.
One, how long did it take for the case to be processed? And two, what happened to any back wages that might have been owed, if any, to the employees that were affected? And does the board, in effect, collect those back wages if, in effect, those back wages?
Could you identify yourself, Larry?
I miss what Sam said.
Identify yourself
oh.
and your organization.
My name's Larry Nathan. I'm an attorney for the New York State Federation of Physicians.
Thank you.
On those questions, you know, I don't know the exact amount of time that CNN was pending, but it was a long time. And one of the things about the CNN case that I think is characteristic of the challenges associated with some of these questions, and CNN dealt with, as I've already indicated, issues besides just the who is the employer issue. But The hearing in CNN, I think went, I could be wrong, but I think it went 80 days. It was a very, very extensive record. So the case was before the board for a long time. I think most of the cases that are before the board are before the board too long. And my concern, and I think this is shared by other board members, is parties cannot afford to win cases that are pending before the board, and we need to do as much as we can to address that. I believe as a result of the board's decision in CNN, more than 300 or 350 technical employees are owed wages, back wages. I'm not aware of those being collected. I think the CNN case is on appeal, but so that issue remains pending. But I don't believe that there's been any resort to injunctive relief, for example, that would require a partial payment of the board remedy in the case dealing with wages. Another question?
Wait, 1 second.
Yeah, you're now being swarmed by microphones, Ben.
Thanks.
Would you identify yourself?
Ben James, Law 360. I was just wondering if you had any thoughts on what's been going on since the new R case rule took effect in April, and I'm particularly curious about if there's been any difference in either union win rates in elections or the frequency of election agreements, and if so, where that might go in the future.
Well, you know, the better people to answer those questions are, I think, to my right and to my left, because you know, the board's work with the election rule, the board members' work with the election rule for the time being is complete. And within the agency, the real task of administering the rule lies with the board's general counsel in the regents. And so I would ask
such a good answer.
I think it's my own impression is it's very early in the history of the rule to address issues concerning who's winning what elections and what type of agreements that there are. But I might actually defer to Karen and ask her.
I was going to say that it is too soon, but the general counsel will be compiling that type of metrics, I should say, and eventually we will have some sort of indication of what effect, if any, this has had on the processing of the election.
Are we likely to see any new rulemaking in the short term?
Well, you know, the existing rulemaking took quite a bit of effort in a couple of years, and we do have some other important cases pending. Mark Pierce, our chairman, he has a saying, which is, we love all of our children. But at this point, I can say that there's no active consideration for the rulemaking within the board, but that's always a possibility that the board may reconsider. I wasn't aware that Sam had the right to ask questions, but I suppose that he does.
I don't know if I have the right, but I've asserted the authority. Other questions or comments? Go ahead, sure. Wait. We have trying to get this thing taped. Wait 1 second.
Well, if the employees at CNN or the subcontractor was owed money, why would it take so much time to get them the money?
I think the two issues would be, from a matter of process, the possibility of an appeal, and also the CNN case itself with respect to the question of back pay does involve some questions regarding interim earnings and other things as a matter of standard board law.
Has this order been enforced yet?
Would be addressed
in pending.
Compliance.
Yeah, so the order hasn't
it's
been
pending.
Enforced
Nothing
by the court.
Nothing has happened yet.
Now, under the NLRA, Larry, I think I taught you this when you were my student. The NLRA, NLRA board orders are not self-enforcing. The order is not self-enforcing yet, Larry.
The answer is they have not been paid yet. That is correct.
Thank you very much. My name is James Versace. I'm an attorney at a union side law firm, Long Island, largely in the construction trades, probably to the chagrin of many of the staff here at the regions who see me a lot. I'm keeping in theme with the theme of this conference. are you seeing as a board a lot more cases, or do you feel the joint employer questions are on the rise? Maybe by the nature of what we see a lot in my firm is, I feel like every time I'm filing a petition nowadays, I'm naming two parties because of the fragmentation of so many industries, particularly if I think about in subcontracting facility services. It just seems to be the rule, the norm nowadays. So maybe I'm loading my question, but I mean, from your perspective, do you see that as a continuing theme that the board's going to address for years to come?
Well, first, let me say, I suspect that Regions 2 and 29, they're happy to see you when you walk into the door. You know, it's such a great question, and particularly with your extensive work in the construction industry, because the construction industry is the one industry where we've been seeing this for 50, 60 plus years. And, you know, at least one of the major benchmarks in this area deals with Denver building trades, which dealt with the very important question in the construction context, whether a general contractor is an employer with respect to employees of the subs. And if you just use that as an example, which has been prevalent in the construction industry for 50, 60, 70, 80 years, I think that it's probably true that the economy now involves much more similar types of overlapping relationships, which probably give rise to those issues more frequently. And I think, at least in terms of what we've seen at the board, there are more cases dealing with these types of issues in other industries now than I suspect there were 20 and 30 years ago.
Other questions or comments? Well, seeing none. Thank you, Karen, and thank you, Phil. Thanks. You have earned by your silence a substantial break. We'll see you at 2 o'clock.